हरि ओम। गणानांत्वा गणपतिगं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पता आनश्रुण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनम्। ओं महागणाधिपतये नमः। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। नमस्ते। Param Vedanta team extends a very warm welcome to you all for this new series of classes on Introduction to Upanishad. We wish you all a very happy new year filled with joy, excellent health and prosperity. Friends, the world has gone through a very tough time in 2020. During this tough time, we are fortunate and blessed to have diverted our attention towards spiritual studies. Let's continue with this spiritual journey in this year also. Vedanta is a big ocean of knowledge. Come on, friends, we shall consume as many drops of this great knowledge as possible. To start with, we will try and learn the basics of Vedanta in the first three sessions, followed by the glimpses of Upanishads in the next seven. While these classes will be on Fridays, we will study Prakarana Granthas on every Monday. Coming Monday, that is 18th January, we will start study of selected slokas from Viveka Chudamani. Yesterday, we have celebrated Makara Sankranti festival. This is a festival of worshipping the grains that are grown and the bulls that have helped us in growing these grains. This again reflects our belief in Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma and Vishwarupa. Yesterday also marks the beginning of Uttarayana Punyakala. Wish you all a very happy Sankranti. In today's class, we will study a few elementary aspects of Vedanta from our teachers. As always, our Dr. Hegde sir will navigate the class with his expert comments and inputs. In our tradition, before starting any Shubha Karya or Vidyarambha, we invoke gods or gurus. So, we will start this class with Guru Paduka Stotra. I request Srimati Indumati Venkat to chant select stotras. After her chanting, Dr. Hegde sir will take over. Indu madam.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. अनंत संसार समुद्र तारा नौकायिताभ्याम गुरु भक्तिदाभ्याम वैराग्य साम्राज्यद पूजनाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम शमादि षट्क प्रदवैभवाभ्याम समादिदान व्रत दीक्षिताभ्याम रमाधवांग्रिस्तिर भक्तिदाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम कामादि सर्प व्रज गारुडाभ्याम विवेक वैराग्य निधि प्रदाभ्याम बोध प्रदाभ्याम द्रुतमोक्षदाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम बोध प्रदाभ्याम द्रुतमोक्षदाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम नमो नमः श्री गुरु पादुकाभ्याम।
थैंक यू इंदुमती। ओम अखंड मंडलाकारं व्याप्तं येन चराचरं तत्पदं दर्शितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वेलकम टू द वर्ल्ड ऑफ द उपनिषद्स। द ग्लोरी ऑफ बीइंग अ ह्यूमन बीइंग इज द चॉइस दैट वी हैव इन हाउ वी पर्स्यू आवर गोल्स इन आवर लाइव्स। वी ऑल एंजॉय टेकिंग जर्नीज and there is one journey that we need to take at some stage of our life is a spiritual journey. When we become a spiritual seeker, life becomes a spiritual journey. Unlike other journeys, a spiritual journey is an inner journey. Whenever we are flying, and if you are by the window and if you look out, you see two distinct characteristics, one of a river and the second is of a railway track. A railway track is absolutely straight from one point to another. In contrast, a river is extremely wavy. And if you observe, there are certain positions in the course of the river when the river, instead of flowing from the source towards the goal, decides to take almost a hairpin bend and flows back towards the source. Wherever a river takes a complete bend and begins to flow back to that source, usually on that convexity is a shrine, a temple, or a holy place. This is understood that whenever we take an inner journey, we are closer to God. The terms used is for a river that is flowing, it is called Dhara. And whenever the river decides to take a U-turn, it becomes Radha, a beloved of the Lord. Again, as I said, a spiritual journey does not involve any travel. It does not involve going out. Thanks to technology today, we have the greatest of great gurus available for us at our time, whenever we are free, to be able to speak to us on topics of our choice. And if there is a suggestion, I would suggest that to minimize distraction, if you're able to listen to with headphones, and you will have sitting at home the advantage of a guru guiding us in our spiritual journey. There is a beautiful verse from the Mundaka Upanishad, which I really love, which goes like this: Pariksha Lokan Karmachitan Brahmana. Brahmana here means a wise person, a person who has examined his life. And when you have examined your life and you see what is that you have accomplished over a period of time, the next word is Nirvedyam. Nirvedyam can be translated as Vairagya, or a kind of frustration, because you see, Nasti akrit kritena. All of us as human beings want to accomplish more and more. And you will see the real essence of our craving is for the infinite. And a wisdom reaches that na asti akrita kritena. That means the infinite can never be attained through finite efforts. And when this wisdom is clear, that means, it will be explained later in this class, all finite goals can be termed as bad, bandhakatvam. We become dependent. It creates more and more bondage. Atripti karatvam. It is never completely fulfilling. We always feel it could be better. And dukkha mishritam. That means there is a struggle to achieve, the struggle to maintain, and whether we like it or not, our accomplishments can be taken away from us. And therefore, if you want a defect-free goal, then you go towards a guru. Tad vijnartham. When this wisdom dawns, sa guru meva abhigachet. And what kind of a guru? A kshotriya brahmanishta. And the word there is samitpani. You carry a samitpani to such a person. Samitpani is indication of your past, that you're willing to let go, you surrender to a guru. And now, whenever we enter into the world of the Upanishads, it is a U-turn that we are turning from, a new journey from samsara to moksha. Why is this journey? Krishna, the Bhagavad Gita in the 8th chapter, has described this world as dukkhalaya. Each morning when you open the newspaper, in our own lives, with our own physical bodies and minds, we experience sorrow. If not within our own homes, outside our homes, we see there is so much of sorrow in this world. When Buddha became enlightened, his first understanding is this world is full of sorrow, and all spiritual measures are to see how you can find an answer to sorrow. Swami Paramarthanandaji has put our life as MBBS. It is so repetitive. It becomes, after some time, meaningless, boring, burdensome struggle. And a spiritual journey can help us to move from MBBS to MJBS. This is extremely difficult to comprehend in the beginning. What does MJ mean? That this world that I experience, which looks absolutely real, which I can experience useful world is Mithya Jagat. Mithya Jagat means it is of a lower order of reality compared to the real me. And the real me is BS or Brahma Satyam that I need to discover. Once I discover the truth of my nature, suddenly the world becomes a Mithya or of a lower order of reality. There are various stages in a spiritual journey. The first is Jnana Yogyata, when I do certain exercises which bring about a certain eligibility for spiritual knowledge. Once I have achieved a certain amount of eligibility, that is when the guru comes and the guru will be able to give you spiritual wisdom. Once I have the spiritual wisdom, there is a big exercise which takes over a period of time that is called from Jnanam to Jnana Nishta, when this knowledge becomes an emotional strength which becomes anchored into every part of my body. There are certain exercises of how you can attain to this, and that will be dealt in class today. And these are called Karma Yoga and Upasana Yoga, both of these which are required to get us Jnana Yogyata or eligibility for spiritual knowledge. Actual Jnana Prapti is through Shravanam and Mananam, through listening to Vedantic scriptures for a length of time under a competent acharya. Jnana Nishta happens through Vedantic meditation or through Nidityasanam. How do we know that we are progressing right? Swamiji gives us a very nice personal inventory in an acronym called FIR. F stands for frequency of emotional disturbances. It will be our experience that I tend to get less upset now than before. My frequency has reduced. Second is the intensity of my emotional disturbances have become much less. Intensity can be classified into three. Level one is mental. I may be disturbed, but I can mask it because it is at the mental level. Then the intensity becomes more. You will see it in my speech, in the volume or in the tone of my voice, that my speech is affected when I get a little more upset when it comes to level two or verbal. When it becomes more intense, the whole body is affected. So part of a spiritual evolution is when the intensity of the emotional disturbances reduce. And finally, R is the recovery period, how quickly I'm able to get back to my equilibrium. Before we start a journey, it is important to say that, am I fit for this journey? There is a very nice work by Acharya of Sringeri Mata called Jiva Yatra. Jiva Yatra is based on the Kathopanishad Ratha Kalpana, the chariot example, where our body is compared to a chariot. The horses represent the sense organs. The horses are controlled by the mind, which represent the reins. The important question is, who is the driver of my life? In all of us, there is the higher me. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. If I have that wisdom to put the higher self in me on the driver's seat, then my spiritual journey becomes a very clear journey. Before we enter into the world of the Upanishads, for the first three classes, we'll be touching on certain fundamentals of Vedanta, and the opening class will be by Dr. Sundar, who will speak on Purusharthas and our scriptures or Shastras. Dr. Sundar, please.
Hari Om, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. The word Purushartha has two parts, Purusha to mean Manushya or humans, and Artha to mean goal or destination. So the word Purushartha essentially describes the purpose of one's life. As we see in the next slide, scriptures say that all possible human goals can be together classified into four goals, the most basic of which is Artha. This includes the goals one sets, the endeavors one take towards security, which can include one's housing, clothing, food, shelter. Once these basic goals are met, man then looks for some comforts and enjoyments beyond the needs of security. This is called Kama Purushartha. Once artha and kama are comfortably met, reasonably met, then man looks for perpetuation of artha and kama in his future days of life and in his future generation. This is the dharma purushartha, which can also be called as adrishtam, punyam, good luck, or good fortune. Before we go to the fourth purushartha, as we see in the next slide, the shastras pool together the dharma artha kama purushartha together and call them as worldly goal or prayas or samsara. This is because they have some common features. These common features, the scriptures call them as defects. And as we have already seen in the Pariksha Lokan verse, these defects are, there is sorrow involved in acquiring them, maintaining them, and there is no permanence in them. And eventually when they are lost, there is sorrow. The second defect is that they are not fulfilling. They do not give contentment. However much we have, we still want more. The third defect is that once I get used to them, it is no longer a luxury. It becomes a necessity. I cannot live without them. I get bonded to them and I lose my freedom. So intelligent human beings, after having tried all these three goals and sensed the absence of lasting happiness fulfillment, may question if there is anything else that I need to do for more permanent happiness. For such people, the scriptures say that yes, there is another goal, which is the moksha purushartha or shreyas. And the scriptures make a startling revelation that that goal is in you only. As we see in this next slide, moksha purushartha, which is also called as the foremost or parama purushartha, is a condition where I have now got free from the slavery with regards to dharma, artha, kama. What it means is whether dharma, artha, or kama is present or not, it doesn't affect my inner condition of fulfillment of lasting happiness. This mental strength, immunity, resistance, toughness is what the scriptures call as the fourth purushartha, which is placed diametrically opposite to samsara. As we see in the next slide, once a person is introduced to this moksha purushartha, obviously he'll now be interested to know how to attain it. So the scriptures present a Guru Shastra Sampradaya of converting prayas to shreyas, of moving from the worldly goals of samsara to moksha purushartha. Swami Paramarthanandaji classifies and mentions that the entire scriptural literature comprises of six layers. The first fundamental foundational layer, as we see in this slide, is the Vedas. As we see in the next slide, the Vedas are seen in our tradition as revelations from the God. So they are apaurusheya. They have been transmitted through the generations by word of mouth, by hearing, by Karna Parampara. Therefore, they are called as Shruti. The Vedas have different categories in them. As we see here, the last part of the Veda is called as the Vedanta. Then we move to the second layer, as in the next slide, which is called as Sutra. So if the Vedas were to be looked as flowers strewn across multiple topics which are not categorically placed, the sutras are codified, classified, arranged together in a compact form. These are also called as nutshell literature or cryptic statements. The reason for them being cryptic is that this enables them to keep the contact, the context, as well as the content intact through several generations. The third layer of literature, as we see in the next slide, is called as Smriti. These are remembered literature. These are based on the Vedas, but the author for this are ancient rishis. They are again codified, classified, and in a Smriti literature, the authors have elbow room to explain and elaborate on certain topics of the scriptures. These are in metrical form or poems, and thereby their content is maintained through the generation. We now see the fourth and the fifth layers in our scriptural literature, where these are again in metrical form. Here the authors have further more elbow room to elaborate. Therefore, certain important topics from the scriptures are painted on a vast canvas, either as stories in the Puranas or in the form of some content of the history in the Itihasas. The examples for the Puranas are the 18 Puranas by Vyasacharya, and Itihasa are the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. We now see the last layer, the sixth layer, which is called as Bhashyam. This comprises of commentaries by more recent Acharyas like Adi Shankaracharya on important texts of the scriptures. One may now wonder, with such a vast literature, where to start and how much to read. So as we see in the next slide, Adi Shankaracharya laid down what is called as Prasthana Trayam, or the three most important texts which a serious seeker has to take to. These are the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita, and Brahma Sutras. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sundar, for giving us a nice overview of human goals or purusharthas. And once you're clear about what is this Parama Purusharta, the next step is, how do I work on it? What are the scriptures that are available and how do we go on? As we have moved from the Gita to the Upanishads, we have to see ourselves as maybe like a postgraduate student. And therefore, we will be able to give you, it will be more of the student's onus to look for more detailed information. What a teacher can give is only a bird's eye view. And we will give you certain references where the sources of this information, where we can go into greater details. We will now come to the three or four important sadhanas, which will give us the eligibility to Brahma Vidya, beginning with Karma Yoga. Ullas, please.
Hari Om Sir, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. As we have seen that the Param Purushartha is Mumukshutvam, Moksha, and for that we need Mumukshutvam. So next slide. We see that what is needed as the first step for any Mumukshu is Karma Yoga. As you would notice, Karma Yoga is made up of Karma plus Yoga. Here Karma refers to proper action, not just any action, proper action. And with what attitude that action must be done is covered in the yoga part. Now let's look at what exactly do we mean by action here. The next slide we see there are three types of actions that are prescribed. The first one is the sattvic. These are the compulsory actions as prescribed by the scriptures. These promote our spiritual growth. These take us towards the upward journey. The rajasic ones are allowed, they're not compulsory. But these are primarily for material growth, not spiritual growth in particular. The tamasic ones are banned because they take us into a downward journey and they demote our spiritual growth. Now let's see what these sattvic actions are. As I said, these are compulsory actions. These are not based on choice or likes or dislike that I can not do something or do something only. These are the things that we must do as is told in the scriptures. Now, these are all nishkama karmas. Nishkama means that these will not create any material benefits. Obviously, they have benefits, but these are intangible. They will not give me name, fame, etc., but they will grow me spiritually. What are these? So for some classification is given for our better understanding. The first one, there are these five mahayajnas. The first one is the deva yajna, in which we worship the Lord, we do puja, japa, whatever we do, we should just not do it mechanically. We should have our wholeheartedness in it, how much ever time we want to devote in that. The second one is the Pitra Yajna. Lord Rama is a great example of that it has to be unconditional. Whatever Dashrath does or Ma Kaikeyi does, we always revere them. Even that is true for forefathers, that whenever the special occasions, special ceremonies are demanded, we must do those actions. The third one, and of my personal favorite, is the Brahma Yajna, in which we need to understand and promote the scriptures. Not just read them, not just put them in the God shelf and then offer flowers, but understand the meaning and purport behind them. And then we revere the rishis. If we know, most of the mantras actually remember those rishis who brought those mantras in our lives. So we do that. Manushyajna. This is also very important in today's world. We have Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, such nice prayers in which we serve our fellow beings. We make sure they're all healthy and all good. This way, we will all be going away from all the social imbalances and all. We protect the poor, we serve the needy and all. Bhutyajna. This is also very important because in our own thinking, in our own benefits, if we are ruining the environment or the ecology, then those balances get disbalanced and it is all downward from there. Now, all these are important. All these are necessary. We can only change their proportions. We can shuffle them around, but we cannot omit any one of them. And many times, because these do not have tangible benefits, so we tend up deprioritize them. And these are the first ones to get on the chopping board. The second is the rajasic action. Now, this action, next slide, we see that these are sakama karma. These are mainly done for name and fame. It is mainly for me and my family and my closed ones. It will give me material growth, but not so much in the spiritual world. But it will not take me down also. So these are not prescribed or they are not compulsory, but they're not banned either. Even there are rituals mentioned in scriptures which will tell how we can get these material benefits in a better way. The third ones are the tamasic actions. These are banned. These are nishiddha karmas. We must not do them because these give us selfish gains or like perceived selfish gains at the expense of others. For example, violence, cheating, etc. Now this we have understood in a nutshell what action is. Now in the next slide, we would see that most of the times we are unhappy because we are struggling with something and all struggle is internal. And Swamiji says that every internal struggle is because of our attitude. So we need to understand what that proper attitude is. So that is mental state of equanimity, how we can be samatvam, as Krishna calls it. Only then when we are calm, we can respond to a situation and not just react. And then we will do our biggest spiritual practice of learning from our experiences. And how we can do that, some of the methods are given are we accept whatever situation is there because not always we have the choice of what we have to do or what result we get. We don't do comparison with others of our weakness against their strengths. We have a humility that I am not doing everything, that kartritva bhav, that doership is the main culprit. We must do still always the karma, but not with that kartritva bhav. We should always think I'm expressing the divinity through me as an instrument. And then this is the best way, that whatever we do it as an offering to the Lord. And then whatever we receive as a prasad. We don't compare the prasad. We don't say how we can improve the prasad and all. So this is a very important attitude. Now, what are the benefits of karma yoga? We see in the next slide. It will give me inner growth. If whenever I am in a dilemma of which action to do or not, it will give me, once I have this understanding, what to prioritize. And this is a very important step for getting competence for Brahma Vidya, as Sir was also mentioning. And it will also give us conducive environment, sufficient punyam to make sure that we get all is that is needed to perform our Brahma Vidya, like finding a guru. And even if we have found one, making the best use of him. So these are the benefits of Karma Yoga. So in nutshell, the take home message is proper action, proper attitude. We must do more of sattvic karmas, reduce rajasic and totally avoid tamasic as much as we can. We perform those panchamahayajnas, do the Ishwar Arpana and Prasada Buddhi, and then gain competence for moksha. And then the next step is the Upasana Yoga. Thank you, sir. Hari Om.
Thank you, Les, for giving us a good overview of a very important sadhana, which gives us a yogyata, which purifies our mind and makes our minds more receptive for Brahma Vidya. Throughout our waking days, working day, we have some work or the other to do. And the key is how I can do it as Ishwar Arpana Bhava or Prasada Bhava. With more skill, we will realize that it is my need. I'm not doing anybody a favor. And more importantly, as you mentioned, there is no sense of I am doing it. Whenever I'm trying to prove something, there is a lot of ego involved, a lot of effort involved. The real skill in action is yogaha karmasu kaushalam. The skill in action is what is called inaction in action. When you allow an action to happen through you, when there is a certain amount of body disidentification, when you get more and more involved, and that is why karma yoga can be a wonderful sadhana for chitta shuddhi and make your mind ready. We have another technique specifically for the mind, and that will be dealt by our psychiatrist, Dr. Divakar, Upasana Yoga.
Dr. Divakar. Thank you, sir. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Good evening, everyone. The majority of the river water is unutilized as it flows wastefully into the sea. Only when a dam is built across a river, water can be conserved and constructively used for irrigation, consumption, electricity generation, etc. Likewise, human beings have tremendous internal strength, which normally is unutilized. We need a dam to conserve and use our untapped energies so that we can channelize them for a constructive purpose. The dam we are in need is Upasana Yoga, and the constructive purpose we are after is Jnana Yoga and eventually Moksha. Upasana Yoga is the discipline of integrating the personality, which is a prerequisite for Jnana Yoga. It consists of various types of meditations for the development and refining of our mind. It is important to note that Upasana Yoga is neither a source of knowledge nor it gives moksha, but it makes us eligible to progress spiritually to the path of self-knowledge, which is Jnana Yoga. Shankaracharya calls Upasana Yoga as Samadhi Yoga. Upasana Yoga primarily deals with mind conditioning, but we need to have a better control over our physical health and speech and use them as stepping stones to gain the mastery over our mind. The conditioning of personality is explained by Swami Paramarthananda Ji by dividing our personality into the three layers: Kayika, the physical body conditioning; Vachika, speech conditioning; and Manasika, the mental conditioning. Now let us look at each layer now. In the next slide, we will see the first one is the Kaya, the conditioning of the physical personality. Whether for the material pursuit or for spiritual, a good physical health is very, very important. Rightly, there is a lot of emphasis on the good physical health and the immunity during this current pandemic. In the chapter 6 of Bhagavad Gita, Dhyana Yoga, the significance of good physical health and the harmony is highlighted, and that has followed the Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga. A spiritual seeker should follow a balanced lifestyle with the mastery over diet pattern, following the time-tested routines with yoga, pranayama, and the good sleep hygienes and exercises. Challenge for us in these fast-paced, technology-driven age is that we all fall prey for the fast food and the sedentary lifestyle and the unhealthy addictions. It is said that one who cannot voluntarily give time for health will have to forcibly give time for diseases. We must prioritize our health. Now let's look at the second layer, which is Vachika, in the next slide. The speech conditioning, also called as Vak Tapas. Shankaracharya in the Viveka Chudamani says, the first step of spiritual pursuit is Vang Nirodha, the verbal conditioning. Speech is the reflection of our thoughts and emotions. We know how much damage can wrong words cause. To keep the mental balance, it is necessary to introspect and plan our speech. It's better to avoid getting into arguments, and lesser spoken the better, especially when we are emotionally disturbed. Swami Anubhavananda Ji beautifully says, as spiritual seeker, we shouldn't talk about our past with others, and we should not talk to ourselves about our own future. This helps us to be in the present. In the chapter 17 of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says our speech should have these four qualities: Satyam, Anudvegakaram, Priyam, and Hitam. Satyam, talking only truth. It is said that to know the absolute truth, one must be truthful in the empirical plane also. satyam eva satyam jayate. Anudvegakaram. Our speech shouldn't harm others. Priyam and hitam. It should be polite, soft and helpful for the listeners. If we observe these qualities, generally we don't have much to talk. Now let's look at the third layer, which is manasika, the mental conditioning, through different kinds of meditations. All meditations can be broadly classified into four types. First one, the relaxation meditation. As the name says, it is this in this form of meditation, primary aim is to relax one's own body and the mind. This can also be called as the de-stressing meditation. This can range from simple breathing techniques, breath monitoring, to progressive muscle relaxation meditations. The second one is the focusing or concentration meditation. This is working on our attention and concentration. This is much required now as all of our attention span is coming down, particularly for the children, because of the excessive usage of the screen and the mobile phones. Scriptures prescribe Manasa Puja, Nama Japa, the mental chanting of Ishta Devata, to improve our concentration. The third one is the expansion meditation. It is training and expanding our mind to visualize the totality of the creation, seeing everything in the creation, including the entire cosmos, as the manifestation of the God. This is also called as Vishwarupa Dhyanam. Meditating of space, Akashopasana, is an example of expansion meditation. This meditation helps us to put our daily problems in a perspective, as everything in the material life is so insignificant when we expand our mind to the entire cosmos. The fourth one and the most important form of meditation is value meditation or transformative meditation. It is meditating and being mindful on our thoughts with a view of changing them for good. Anything and everything we do is anchored by our mind, in particular our thoughts. Most thoughts are automatic thoughts, but what patterns of thoughts we get is as a result of how we are groomed into the personality that we are today. Let's look at this nice sequence in the next slide. Watch your thoughts, they become your words. Watch your words, they influence your actions. Watch your actions, they become your habits. Watch your habit, they become your character. And watch your character, it determines your destiny. If we analyze it closely, it is our thoughts which determine our destiny. Yad bhavam tad bhavati. As you think, so you become. In the chapter 16 of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about the values needed for spiritual growth called Daivi Sampat and those which are a hindrance called Asuri Sampat. Each of these value, each of these virtues are originated from a thought and they end up becoming a value. Mind is such a powerful instrument which is vital for our daily transactions and it determines our destiny. Mind is like the air. It is so subtle and vital and we often ignore this. And then that results in samsara and suffering. So let's mind our mind at all times. And through Upasana Yoga, integrate our physical, verbal, and mental conditioning to gain the Jnana Yogyata and proceed towards the spiritual knowledge, Jnana Yoga. Hari Om, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Divakar, for an excellent presentation on Upasana Yoga, which essentially is working on the mind, which is our greatest instrument, the greatest tool that we have available for us. As the Amrita Bindu Upanishad says, Mana eva manushyanam karana bandha mokshaye. The mind which is wrongly tuned can be the cause of all our bondage and all our suffering. The same mind which is properly programmed, that's why we learn through Upasana Yoga. Upasana Yoga involves, because the mind is so much linked to my body and speech. So one of the ways, and the mind, as Dr. Divakar said, is so abstract, it is like air. So we need to see how we can work on our body, to work on our breathing, and through understanding, to work on the mind through all these techniques. Essentially, it is through Upasana over a period of time that the mind is available for us when we want, for as long as we want, to be available for the teacher. And because this whole process is a mental exercise, although Brahma Vidya is agocharam. It is something beyond the mind. And yet we have to use our mind and intellect. This is the only tool that is available. And this is what gives us jnana yogyata. And with this, we come to the next topic of what is this jnana yoga? Dr. Anupama, if you can explain this to us.
Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Jnana yoga. This is a discipline meant for gaining the knowledge of Brahman, the yoga of wisdom, the cultivation of discrimination between Atma and Anatma. What is the purpose of Jnana Yoga or Atma Vidya? This is for the attainment of Moksha Purushartha. What is Moksha? Freedom from bondage or dependence. What is the cause of bondage? The first three Purusharthas, Dharma, Artha and Kama. Artha means procurement of security. Kama is the desire for comfort or luxury. And Dharma is building up of punya or the adrishta bank balance. Moksha, also called mukti, is an inner freedom from dharma, artha and kama. What are the types of bondage? Bharaha, the stress of possession, and emptiness or loneliness due to non-possession of objects and people. Ubhayata pashaha rajjuhu. Either way, we see there is a problem. What are the virtues of freedom? First, acceptance of that situation which cannot be changed, the courage to change that which can be changed, and the discretion to know the difference between the two. How do I get self-knowledge? Knowledge, whether para, the material, or apara, the spiritual vidya, is attained by using an instrument called pramana. Apara vidya is acquired by perception or inference. Perception is possible by using our five sense organs, and therefore it is called Paurusheya Pramana. But we see these sense organs are extroverted instruments. They are incapable of studying the subject behind the instruments. For example, the eyes can neither see themselves nor the seer. Therefore, the subject, I, cannot be subject to objectification. We therefore need a sixth pramana. This is called Shastra Pramana or Shabda Pramana. Since it is extrinsic, it is called a Paurusheya Pramana. The technique of using Shastra Pramana or scriptural study is called Jnana Yoga. This is the inquiry into Vedanta with the help of a guru. There are three stages of Jnana Yoga. First, Shravanam. This is the systematic and persistent listening to the scriptures or teachings for a long period of time with the help of a competent guru. Next, Mananam. Mananam is the resolution of all intellectual doubts till I can say with conviction, Aham Brahma Asmi. Third, Nidityasanam. Nidityasanam is the transformation of this intellectual knowledge into an emotional strength. So I can say Aham Brahma Asmi by identifying with the Aham of the Aham Brahma Asmi. What is Jivan Mukti? Through Shravana, Manana and Nidityasana, a person becomes a Jivan Muktaha. This is a state of being enlightened though embodied, anchored to the aham of aham brahma asmi, realizing that you are the absolute, yet particularized as an individual in this vyavaharika prapancha. Therefore, we must remember that we are an inseparable mixture of atma, the sakshi chaitanyam or original consciousness, the absolute I, and the anatma, the ahankara or relative I. In every transaction, the sakshi is the adhishtanam of the ahankara I. Through jnana yoga, I realize that the ahankara I is only empirical and I am the sakshi chaitanyam, the Brahman. This is the essence of transformation, transcending form, the body-mind complex and identifying with the aham of aham brahma asmi. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anupama, for telling us what is Jnana Yoga. As you will see, immediately the whole topic becomes much more subtle and difficult to understand. But at the same time, the benefits are enormous. It gives what is called a Jivan Mukta status. It gives you what is Parama Purushartha, the highest goal a human being can achieve. That is why you have conflicting versions in our scriptures. In the Kathopanishad, it is said a spiritual journey is like Shurasadhara. It is like walking on a razor's edge, extremely difficult. At the same time, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna has said, Susukam, it is so simple. So simple to whom? For one who is prepared, for one who has yogyata. And that is why the Upasana Yoga and Karma Yoga are so important for us to get that mental preparation. Once the mental preparation is there, then it becomes like Hasta Amalakiya. It becomes so easy to be able to digest these scriptural wisdom. And it is a matter of time when scriptural wisdom becomes emotional strength and we are able to FIR, what I said, becomes a part of your life. Now let us look at one sadhana, which is a combination of karma, upasana and jnana through bhakti yoga. And it will be Mysore Madhusudan who will be able to explain this to us. Madhusudan, please.
Gurubhyo Namaha. In continuation to various topics what we covered so far, and also as narrated the details in Tattva Bodha, we will try understanding Bhakti Yoga. Tattva Bodha introduces all these technical terms required for conducting self-inquiry. In Sanskrit, it is also called as Paribhasha Shabdaha, the jargons. Bhakti Yoga. The word Bhakti is used in the scriptures in two different meanings. One is bhakti as a devotion towards God. And devotion is nothing but love directed towards a higher principle. Reverential love can be defined as a devotion like Matru Bhakti, Pitru Bhakti, Guru Bhakti, and similarly, Ishvara Bhakti. Further, scriptures point out that all forms of love that a human being entertains is directed towards only three things. As we see in this slide, the first one is whatever goals we want to accomplish in life. This could be seen as an end love. The second one is the one, what is the means to accomplish the end? This could be classified as the love of the means. And finally, the third thing, that object of love is love of oneself. Everyone loves himself or herself. I will call this as itself love. Therefore, all forms of love are only of three categories. And then the scriptures point out that there is a gradation in the intensity of love. Therefore, if we have to grade, means love could be called Mandha Bhakti, end love could be called as Madhyama Bhakti, and self love the ultimate Uttama Bhakti. Now let us apply the same principle to the field of God. If we have got Bhakti, or if a person loves God, what will be the intensity of that love? The scriptures point out that intensity of love depends on how you look upon God. God as a means to achieve goals is around Mandha Bhakti. God as the end goal, Madhyama Bhakti. And God as myself or the oneself is the Uttama Bhakti. Uttama Bhakti is the third rarer form of the love, which is the most intense form of love, in which we look upon God not as the means, not even as the end, but God as a non-different from myself. Soham asmi, soham asmi. Krishna beautifully elaborates this in the 7th chapter and the 12th chapter, also called as Bhakti Yoga of the Gita. What is Bhakti? Love of God in the form of Mandha Bhakti, Madhyama, or Uttama Rupa. Now, as we see in the next slide, we will come to the second meaning of the word Bhakti. The second meaning is bhakti as a course of discipline to accomplish the spiritual goal. So when bhakti means a course of discipline, we use the word bhakti yoga meant for accomplishing the goal. Bhakti yoga is the common name for all the three yogas because bhakti is the common atmosphere or the thread in which all these three yogas are practiced. For example, in karma yoga, the attitude that one enjoys, Ishwararpana bhavana or prasada bhavana. In upasana yoga, how can I meditate upon a god if I don't have bhakti? So as jnana yoga also involves bhakti. Therefore, self-realization or discovery is nothing but a god discovery. Now we see the third meaning to it of bhakti, because when we talk about bhakti, it is love or the devotion towards God. And without understanding the principle of God, how can we discuss the topic of devotion? Because integral part of love is the object of love. Therefore, briefly, let's discuss what is God. Who is the object of your love? Scriptures give three definitions of God broadly. First definition being Jagatkarta Ishwaraha, the creator. The second being Jagatkaranam Ishwaraha, the cause. Finally, the third definition, Jagat Adhisthanam Ishwaraha. In summary, God creates the world, first stage of understanding. God becomes the world, the second stage of understanding. God appears as the world, third stage of understanding. When we are at the initial stage, I have got Ekarupa Bhakti. In the middle stage, my Bhakti is Anekarupa. And finally, I am at the Arupa Bhakti. As we see in the final slide, and to conclude, here is the consolidated view of the whole Bhakti Yoga, which mainly comprises of 9 forms of bhakti. First three, that is Manda, Manda Bhakti, Madhyama Bhakti, and Uttama Bhakti. So this could be classified as Bhavana Drishtya Bhakti Trayam. Next three being Karma Yoga Rupa Bhakti, Upasana Yoga Rupa Bhakti, Jnana Yoga Rupa Bhakti. This could be classified as Sadhana Drishtya Bhakti Trayam. Finally, Ekarupa Bhakti, Anekarupa Bhakti, and Arupa Bhakti being the Devata Drishtya Bhakti Trayam. So to conclude, the word bhakti is used in all these meanings, and therefore any moment or any time we talk about bhakti, we should keep in mind the context and grasp the meaning. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Madhusudan, for giving us a very nice kaleidoscopic view of bhakti is and how bhakti can encompass all sadhanas. The important thing is that you can be both Ekarupa and Arupa Bhakta at the same time. You can express devotion to God with form, and you can also have the understanding of Aham Brahmasmi. And that is the synthesis of what Bhakti Yoga is all about. With that, we have come to the end of today's class. I will just give you a glimpse of what we are in for the next week. The next week's class is all about qualifications. As I said, if you are entering into the world of the Upanishads, if you are entering into Jnana Yoga, we need a certain amount of qualifications. This is the third verse from the 7th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where Shri Krishna says, Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschid yatati siddhaye. That means among the thousands and thousands of people, very, very few have the eligibility to enter into the world of spirituality. And I can be certain that all of those in this class today, all of those who are listening, have certainly got that qualification, because if you have not had that qualification, you will not be able to enter into the portals of the Upanishadic studies. But having entered, Krishna gives a warning. Yatatam api siddhanam kaschin mam veti tatvataha. Which means, among these, it is not that all of them will finally attain to the goal. We need to be able to enhance our qualifications. So that means we need to work on jnana yogyata all the time. And there are Swamiji has listed the yogyata or the qualifications, which will be explained in the next class as DDDD. What are the 4 Ds? The first is a clear distinction between what is permanent and what is impermanent. What is Atma and what is Anatma? And anything Anatma is not there in all three periods of time. which we'll be discussing also in the next class. What do you mean by all three periods of time? Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti, that which is there in all three periods of time is Sat, and everything else is Asat. Now, more and more we enter into the world of spirituality, we attain to what is called Vairagyam. That means anything that is Asat, anything that is temporary, my interest in them will come less. I have highlighted the third D, which is called Mumukshutvam. If this quality is there, that means I want it at any cost. If a person has that Tivra Mumukshutvam, the next or the discipline that is required, I am ready to make my mind under control, senses under control. Uparama, my interest now will reduce to that which is absolutely essential. I'm ready to be mentally strong for whatever is required. Shraddha means whatever my teacher says and what the gospel says is 100% true, even though it may not appeal to me right now. And then I have a single-pointed mind that is called Samadhana. This will be dealt by two of our speakers in the next class. And then we have another important topic of our body. Essentially, as I said, the whole spiritual work is what is Atma and Anatma. Anything that I can see and experience comes under the world of Anatma, which includes my body. And the ancient Indians have classified our bodies into three bodies, or it can be classified into five koshas. And the other thing is called, we live not in one world, but we live in three worlds. In the world of the Jagrat, which we now experience, we also have a dream world, and then we miss both these experiences in deep sleep. These topics are extremely important to understand, which will be dealt in the next class. And if we have a clear understanding of that, then our foundations into the study of the Upanishads becomes very easy. Swami Paramarthananda has given us two fundamental principles of Vedanta. I want you to remember these fundamental principles all the time. The first fundamental principle is I am other than whatever I experience. And this is what is called Atma Anatma Viveka, which means whatever I experience, including the world around me, which I clearly know is not me. The important step is this body and mind is only an instrument through which I function. It is not the real me. The real me is the experiencer who's using this body to communicate. And the second and important mind-boggling principle is that all attributes that I experience belong to the object of experience. I have no attributes. When I have no attributes in time, I am there for all time. And that makes me Sat. I am of the nature of consciousness. Therefore, I am Chit. When I have no limitations of any kind, because I have no attributes, I am Ananta. And wherever I experience Anantatvam, I experience Purnatvam or Ananda. If this is understood, I would like to introduce to you a certain sadhana that we need to do every morning. And this particular mantra is called the Pratasmarami. Pratasmarami means early in the morning, I want to meditate on few things. Swamiji has said, if you're able to count our blessings, our life will be much more joyous and much more fulfilled, because you can never be grateful and miserable at the same time. Whenever you are grateful, the quantum of the misery in our life immediately becomes less, because a grateful person is a bigger person than whoever he is. And Swamiji wants us to be all the time grateful for something exceptional and wonderful that we have. And that is the Atma Tattva. The problem is, even those of us in the spiritual path tend to take this Atma for granted. For example, any object that you see, even if you see my hand, you see my hand, but you forget to see that you're able to see my hand because of the presence of the light on the hand. The light on my hand is not part of the hand, but because of the light, you're able to see, which means any object that I'm able to see is that object plus light. Swamiji enlightens you to the fact that you are able to see any object because of the light on that object. And that light of object is seen by the light of consciousness. And this exercise by moving from the object to the subject is the whole process of meditation, which is done in the early morning called Pratasmarami. In the course of these three classes of the introduction, I'd like to introduce you to these three verses very briefly, and I will give you sources where you can go through these words, and so that you will not only remember these words, but you will be knowing each meaning of each of these words. Pratasmarami, early in the morning, I meditate, I think about Hridi Samspuratam. That means from the internal, from my heart, it comes out as effulgent, that Atma Tattva within me, which is of the nature, as I described, as Sat Chit Sukham or Sat Chit Ananda, which is Paramahamsa Gatim. What is Paramahamsa Gatim? A sannyasi who is the seeker of the highest, that is the Paramapurushartha, is called a Paramahamsa Gatim. And what is this? What is this? What do you seek for Turiyam? We will again understand it in the next class, which is part of Avastha Trayam. Avastha Trayam is Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti. But there is one state which is supporting all of them and which is independent of all of them, which is neither the waking dream or the deep sleep. And because you have no name for that, because it has no attributes, that is called the Turiyam. So the fourth word there is called Turiyam. This Atma Tattva is the witness of Swapna, Jagrata, Sushupti, which continuously happens like a merry-go-round. So I am that Atma who is a witness of my waking state, dream state, and deep sleep state. And finally, the last verse says, Tad Brahma Aham. I am that Brahma, which is Nishkalam. Nishkalam means it cannot be divided. It does not mean I have one Brahman and you have another Brahman. The Brahman or the Atma Tattvam that is functioning and speaking through me is the same that is listening through you. Nacha Bhuta Sangaha. I am not the components of all these four elements. So in the next few classes, I will tell the explanation of the other two verses, but this is a sadhana that I would like all of us to do, to remember this Pratasmarami and chant it every morning. And this gives you jnana yogyata by itself. I will request Venkatesh Prasad to conclude this class. Venkatesh, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, friends, for being a part of a great beginning of another yatra in the world of Upanishads. We will come out with some more topics of Vedanta next Friday. Before that, we will commence study of Viveka Chudamani, a great work of Adiguru Sri Shankara Bhagavat Pada, on Monday, 18 January 2021. That marks the end of today's session. Let's meet on Monday, same time. Please log in by 6:45 p.m. local time. As always, we'll conclude the session with Shanti Mantra. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om.
Yes, sir, we're good. Thank you.